Well, this is the bad part of the afternoon, I'm sure. After a nice, obviously warm meal outside, you must be feeling a little drowsy. Maybe that's why they got the psychiatrist to speak to you. I am a psychiatrist, and a psychiatrist is a doctor. As a doctor, you know, I've been trained to make diagnosis, to identify illness. I don't consider myself a health expert. I consider myself an illness expert. And therein lies the problem. You know, because we are illness experts, sometimes we don't know the concept of recovery. We don't know the concept of how people get well. And we spend the little time that we have, and you've heard about how Singapore doctors spend so little time compared to many other parts of the world, that we don't know what you're doing outside of those hours that you're not... well, some of those hours are spent waiting for us, and then the other hours when you are at home and doing all your own things. So the doctor is really quite handicapped. I've always thought that as a doctor, I do not know much about my patients, and that's why I chose to be a psychiatrist. Maybe you're giving me a bit more time. I do get to spend 1 hour with my patients from time to time, unlike the other doctors. I'm also a caregiver. My mother was diagnosed with dementia about 3 years ago, and of course, recently she had a stroke, and she's actually paralyzed, unable to talk on her bed at home. I have had to, with my family, care for her, and it's been a tough experience, you know, one that makes me take my work a little bit more seriously over the years. I am a patient. I've been in our healthcare system. I try not to tell people when I go to see the doctor or the hospital, and I try to experience it for myself because I think it's important to sort of understand what it means to be a patient so that we can make it better for patients, caregivers, in this healthcare journey. And I call it a journey because we are always in touch with the healthcare system from time to time. Of course, I like to think that the healthcare system is more proactive. It doesn't wait until you're sick, that it actually goes out and reaches out. And that's why I want to thank the organizers of this conference, because it is an attempt to reach out to patients and their families. Some of you may not be caregivers, may just be members of the public interested in what it means to be a patient. So I think that really makes this conference quite unique. I was given this topic, Love Without Walls, and I wasn't quite sure. That we SAMH had produced a book, and when we did the book, it was the idea of walls really about how we have many silos of care. You know, as a psychiatrist, when I used to think, I remember once I was on the airplane, you know, and then someone says, is there a doctor on board? Then I'm thinking, oh, should I get up? Should I hope for another doctor? And so far, I've been very lucky. You know, every time I go, there's either a cardiologist or family physician there, so I just stand around and help, you know, and say, can I help? Then when they hear that I'm a psychiatrist, they say, thank you very much, you can sit down. But there have been times where I actually have to practice as a real doctor, trying to care for our patients. And when patients collapse, and they do, you know, I'll tell you this: in mental health, our patients die 20 years earlier than the average Singaporean. So all of you, do you know that? Someone with a chronic mental illness like schizophrenia actually die 20 years younger. Average Singaporean die now how old? 80. 60 years. That's the life expectancy of a person with schizophrenia. Can you imagine? Why can't we improve the care for these patients? Well, I'm going to share some of that with you today. Okay, so we have basically, this is community and the patient, right? That's where we all live in. And then we have, you know, various aspects of care, from primary care, from care, family care, our fantastic healthcare system, of which Tan Tock Seng is one of them, right? Community and all that. This is the immediate community around patients. IMH actually is a tertiary center, okay? We are up here. We have been somewhat excluded from mainstream healthcare for a long time. You may think, well, you know, because mental illness is very different. I don't know why it was so. But you know, IMH is built in the jungles, all right? Those of you who know, we have no MRT line that actually leads to us. even though soon we'll have a general hospital within about four streets away, and that will have an MRT station. IMH was built far away from civilization because people don't like to hear about mental illness. Today, you want to know what IMH was like in the past, go to Indonesia. Go to some of those asylums, the villages. Okay, they still tie patients up, you know, sometimes with chains, with ropes in the backyard, and because they don't know what to do with mentally ill, chronic mental illness. So that's one problem in IMH that we had for a long time. And we had to spend a lot of time, really, in the last 20 years to try and educate that mental health is something that affects all of us, that any one of us can have mental illness. Any of you know anyone with a chronic mental illness like schizophrenia? Do you know anyone know? Yeah, quite a number of you. And I'll tell you, it's about 1% of the population. Now, that's not uncommon, all right? They could be your neighbor. Now, we do get stories of neighbors who have mental illness, and every time the other neighbor will say, can you please call the police, bring the person to IMH. IMH only has 2,000 beds. If we bring 1% of the population here, I don't know, you know, we'll overflow. In fact, would you believe, you read the newspapers about hospitals being full, right? Tan Tock Seng is one of the fullest. IMH actually has occupancy rate on a regular basis at close to 90%, and I often get, 90% means it's really full, you know, for a mental hospital. I often get these red alerts that say, hey, this weekend, and one weekend is coming up this weekend, we got red alert, no more beds. So we have to tell the doctor, say, look, we have to think, if someone comes in who's suicidal, who's aggressive, where would we put them? And we have to think of ways and means to put them in different wards and so forth. So we have the same problems as a general hospital, just not highlighted. So since this is a patient conference, I'd like to highlight some of this. Okay, I'll share a little bit about mental health services. And I'm going to interpose my slides. These sets of slides I had actually done to talk about being an inclusive society, where we must, you know, regardless of, and we know everybody reads the pledge, you know, regardless of race, religion, we even say regardless of disabilities, but mental health disorders, chronic mental health disorders, are not classified as a disability in Singapore. So that's something that we have to think about, and maybe can we change? Well, this is IMH's mission, vision and mission, a tertiary hospital, excellence, global leader of mental health care. We do want to promote mental health, and we want to provide good care, and at the same time learn and do research. This is the Singapore Association for Mental Health. Now, SAMH was formed about 47 years ago, by a group of doctors from IMH, from Woodbridge Hospital at the time. The doctors felt, and nurses and social workers, I think the whole multidisciplinary team, felt that, you know, patients, we treat them in the hospital, we get them well, and then we send them out. Then they are rejected by society. Nobody helps them. They can't find a job, and they go on a downward spiral. How many of you travel? Who travels? Okay? You all take, yeah? Have you been to cities where you see people wandering the streets? Sometimes they knock on your windscreen. They ask you to beg for money. Many of them have chronic mental illness. Do you see this in Singapore? Less, right? Yeah, some say yes. There are people begging. Actually, the people begging are, a lot of them are professional beggars. They come from, you know, Laos or Cambodia, Thailand. But the mentally ill are not in the streets because we have been taking care of them. Okay, we've been trying to. And SAMH does some of that. Okay, its mission is really to improve the lives of people with mental illness, promote the acceptance and respect for people with mental illness, and to improve mental resilience. But again, SAMH historically, you know, has always been, again, in the backwaters. We do our job quietly. I'm the president of the association, besides my other job as the chairman medical board in IMH. And I see this work as very important. And the reason why I keep talking about this is because we are having a charity dinner very soon. And we'd like you to come if you can, okay? Buy a table, donate to our cause. Every year, this is our annual fundraising for this work that we do, all right? So if you're interested, go to the website and you can read more about it. And you can buy, it's not expensive. It's about $300, almost $400 for a seat. You get a special dinner done by the Chefs Association, Three Chefs Association, in fact. It's a specially concocted dinner. And you get to get entertained by many musicians, including Dick Lee. He'll be singing. So come, if, you know, it's not it's nice to donate to a good cause. Okay, and a little bit about our services. I'm sure you're all familiar with hospital services. So if you need, here in Tan Tock Seng, they also have services for mental health disorders, and that's probably these specialties. So we have specialty-based and also disease-based services. We're quite comprehensive. In fact, next week, the College of Psychiatrists in Singapore will be formed under the Academy of Medicine. So we are quite a big specialty now. What we do lack is community-based services, and we have some for the young, the elderly, and adults as well, but we need to probably expand some of this. SAMH is a small organization in comparison to IMH. It does have a lot of community-based services linked to trying to help people reintegrate, find jobs, you know, find meaning in life. And I think this slide is too busy for you to see. Basically, it shows that there is a structure for us to provide that. Counseling services, on-site help. We have a drop-in center for people with mental illness who can't find a job but need time. It's almost like a day center, but a voluntary day center. And then we also have a home where people can stay for 1 to 2 years while they get a job, enough money to be able to rent a room for themselves. The unfortunate thing about mental illness is that very often it does impair their cognitive abilities. They may not be able to function at the same level they were when they were not ill. Of course, this is not always true. What we see as psychiatrists is those who get, you know, keep coming back. I think mental illness, even chronic mental illness like schizophrenia, it is curable. The curative rate, unfortunately, is not very well known. We've known local studies, but I'm quite sure that it's curable. But, you know, just imagine, if you have schizophrenia and you got better, you think you go around telling people? No, exactly. And that's why the psychiatrist knows a little better, always tells you that mental illness is incurable. That's my take on it, lah. Because there is some stories about this, there is some science behind this in prevalence studies. The question is, how true is that? This is just to show you the kind of services we have in SAMH. Sorry. Okay, so this is our priorities for the Institute of Mental Health this year. And it's something that I spoke to our doctors about because I felt that, you know, we're so happy over the years in developing the service as an evidence-based treatment for mental illness. We forget that we need to listen to our patients. You may think a psychiatrist says we must listen to our patients. You'll be surprised. Sometimes we don't. I'm the first to say that because we, you know, like everybody else, we spend a lot of time trying to meet the numbers that we see. We have slightly more time. Well, I'm a child psychiatrist. I do have more time. But I'm frequently told by my CEO that you also spend more money. It costs more. So I understand that. And even our group CEO, he always tells me this story about how we are the costliest department in the whole NHG because we spend time. But we need to listen to our patients and identify their needs because sometimes we forget what their needs and wants are different. And sometimes because, and we heard Mui Hong talk a little bit about that, right? Some patients actually have a lot of, they've done their own research. And I'm beginning to see many young patients with schizophrenia who says, look, doctor, I've done this research, you know, I found this area that, you know, is it possible when they're well, when they're, you know, no longer psychotic. And we need to listen to them. So I told our doctors, look, we need to listen and identify their needs. And that should be a priority for ours. And then we need to measure what matters to patients most. We need to be able to cultivate a responsibility for the work that we do as a team. That's our priorities. In the Singapore Association for Mental Health, these are strategies that we wanted to do. Well, many of those with chronic mental illness, I suspect maybe 10% get well spontaneously with good support from the family without medication, I suspect. All right? The rest will need continuous care and support. And about 30% of them will need long-term care and support that, you know, they're unable to work. But we need to find ways and means. Now, one way that we have been doing this in Singapore is putting them in hospital residential care. That's why IMH is now the largest hospital in the whole of Southeast Asia. I can't say Asia because in China and Japan probably have as large hospitals as ours. 2,000 beds,
of which 1,200 are chronic long-term patients. Some of them, when I first joined 20 years ago, they were called unknown. You know, and I said, why is their name unknown? You ask them, what's your name? You say unknown. And then you say, then you look at their notes, it says unknown Chinese or unknown Malay. Their names are not known to them. They have forgotten their names and no one has given them a name. Today we have changed that. Today we have named all our patients. We ask them for their names that they would like and we give them a name. Because it's not right to have anonymous people living in our hospital. So there are people who need care. So perhaps maybe they could go to school. So one of our strategies is to send them to a school program. Okay, you can't work, never mind, go to school. In Singapore, that's quite acceptable because everybody goes to school. In fact, school is very important. we do need to manage to be able to come up with a good way to fundraise. You know, it's easy to fundraise for cancer because cancer survivors tell their stories and cancer survivors are eloquent and able to speak. Mentally ill people, when they recover, we can't get them to tell the story. Today, that's changing because we're getting more people to come forward. But very often, it's not one of those things that people want to put their name after. You know, all our new hospitals got named after people. We said, hey, Woodbridge Hospital also can have a name. Who would like to put a name on Woodbridge Hospital, you know? Wouldn't it be nice to have one? So we need to be able to fundraise. It's not easy. The other part, of course, is to make sure that we run an organization that is responsible for the monies that we have fundraised to make sure that we give back to our patients, you know, something that is worth their while and gives them a meaning in life. So this is actually a book that we compiled on caregivers. That's why I think the organizers asked me to say Love Without Walls. So it was one of the things that SAMH did, and part of that school program is to create a creative hub. You see, art is one of those ways that we have an opportunity to get people to learn things and be very open about learning. So in our creative hub, any one of you can come and join, learn a skill. It could be an artistic skill, it could be craft making, it could be sculpture. And then in that experience, you'll be surprised. Actually, the part of your the group that is learning, some of them are patients, some of them are caregivers, and some of them could be people walking in the public. You pay a very nominal sum, like $10. And the idea was to go through that experience, learn about mental health and mental illness, and hopefully understand and break down the walls that we have, again, the stigma that we have. Alright? This is another book that we did. Okay, I know I'm running out of time. So how do we change mindsets? I think stigma is very important, so a short video just to talk about stigma.
Like any other illness, a mental disorder could affect anyone. In fact, over 450 million people around the world struggle with a mental illness.
Most mental disorders strike during early adulthood. Sadly, the majority of those with a mental condition do not seek help.
Stigma prevents people from seeking help and support. They're afraid of how others may judge them. They also fear losing their friends or their jobs.
Often people with a mental illness are misunderstood, discriminated against, and bullied. They face difficulties finding housing and employment. It is time to change our perception towards mental illness.
Having a mental illness isn't a sign of weakness. You can't just snap out of it. You can't ignore the depressive thoughts.
Not all people with a mental health condition are violent. They are generally no more violent than you or me.
Mental illness is not the same as mental retardation. Mental illness is a condition that changes a person's thinking, mood, behavior, but intellectual functioning may not be affected. Famous people like Nobel Prize winner John Nash and painter Vincent van Gogh also suffered from mental illness.
With early treatments, people with a mental health condition can recover and lead normal lives. So let's accept and support them.
Right, so changing the mindset is quite critical in the work that both IMH and the Singapore Association for Mental Health have to do. So one of the things we think, the young people, because many of us, we are all set in our ways and we have our stigmas and our, you know, discriminatory thinking maybe, but with the young, there's an opportunity to teach. So we have opened up our hospital. Now, IMH is one unique hospital. It's the only hospital in Singapore where you can park freely. All right? I welcome you to come. You want free parking, you know, that's one place. And if you have an idea that you want to set up a social enterprise on site, we'd be happy to help with you because we have a lot of ground. IMH is as big as SGH campus. All right? It's the one large piece of land. So we need to get people to come and visit. We actually have a little museum, and you can, if you're interested, please come and listen to our stories. We do have online education. What you saw that video is part of that on our website. So both SAMH and IMH has websites with information that is quite interesting for you to understand mental illness. The SAMH website actually has accounts by patients talking about their experience and how they went through it. So please go and have a look. Now, this is the creative hub that I talked about. So again, it's really open. A lot of people come, and there's a lot of it's at Goodman Art Center near where's that? Kallang there. Of course, we do regular exhibitions. The World Mental Health Day is in October, just over. A lot of events usually occur, and well, it may be over, but obviously some of this you can glean from our website. So I would recommend that you go and have a look and try and understand. This is one of the exhibits that we did called Picture My World. We got people with mental illness to take photographs and share about their experience.
Express myself through the photographs that I took. I don't think that everybody know how does an OCD person live life. So through my pictures, I hope to tell people this is what we go through every day.
I think this is a very good process, 让我有机会来发表我的心里的感想。
Social inclusion plays a central role in the recovery process of people with mental illness. IMH is embarking on this Picture My World project so as to lend a voice to people with mental illness so that they may share their stories and help others understand their illness and as such destigmatize against mental illness.
Well, I think with this project, I hope that the public will also see that, you know, people living with mental illnesses lead a very normal life like every one of us.
I feel that photography is very suitable for this project because these participants, some of them are not comfortable speaking up about their problems. So I feel that using photography, besides them expressing what they feel, it can also educate the public about what these people are going through.
Okay, so the idea was to give patients with mental illness, PMIs, a voice to share their experience because their experiences are quite unique. It's very hard for you to imagine how it is to hear voices or to experience severe anxiety if you didn't wash your hands or to feel so down that you want to kill yourself. So allowing them to express it either in writing, in art, in the creative arts, it's a way for them to communicate that to us. So patient voice is one of those experiences where I just showed you the video. Burst the Silence campaign is an online campaign by our early psychosis program to share about the difficulties of early psychosis. And we started to do something quite unique, really getting patients to speak. So I think, you know, in the future, maybe next year I get invited again, I'm going to ask a patient to come and talk to you all. And we do have patient advocates who've gone on public TV, and they're willing to share about their experiences. Many of them have also written books. And then this new thing, the idea of hiring patients to be part of that journey, so that new patients and their families understand. So we have peer specialists that both Singapore Association for Mental Health and IMH have hired to be part of our staff. We pay them a normal salary like everybody else, and they have to do all the Singaporean things with HR and everything. And the idea really is to allow them to share their experience, and it's a great way to journey. So I was asking, you know, maybe Tan Tock Seng might consider hiring patient to be part of your team, you know, and maybe even organize this conference in the future, and to be able to share the experience. So that's something that I think it's very powerful, and you know, not just volunteers, like we actually put our money where our mouth is and give them, you know, pay, and we pay them decently. In fact, one of them brought us to the Ministry of Manpower to negotiate. So you can see that, but that's good, you know. I mean, that's not a bad thing. So let's see. I've got one more slide. I've got 29 seconds. Okay, let's see if we can watch this.
I was diagnosed with chronic schizophrenia, depression disorder and anxiety disorder. During then, in 1993, we didn't receive public education about mental health. I felt that I was a lesser human being in a sense.
Yeah. I'm co-caring together with my mom, my maternal grandmother, and she has been diagnosed with Alzheimer's disease. She is 86 years old now. I think the symptom first surfaced as early as 10 years ago, but it got pretty bad in the last 5 years. She wanted to dry some clothes. I stopped her and I said, no, Grandma, you can't shine clothes. It's very dangerous. And she started crying and yelling like a little child who's going through a tantrum. Her crying and yelling didn't stop because she was saying that we didn't give her dignity. And these are moments that it really toys and really pulls you apart as a human being, because the word like, you don't respect me anymore, but actually you respect her so much that you don't want her to do that activity, it's so dangerous.
I'm Elsie, a caregiver for my son, who was diagnosed 8 years ago with schizophrenia. I find him behaving in a weird manner, like for example, he smiled to himself for no reason. After a few times, I feel that it's not quite right. The hospital told me that they suspect my son has this schizophrenia. I just couldn't accept it, you know. I said, God, it's very unfair. Because God has given me polio, then why has He given me a son with schizophrenia again? So at that stage, I was very devastated. We didn't have to tell people. We don't let the neighbor know. We don't let my family people know. We are afraid that they will look at us with colored eyes.
I'm suffering from obsessive compulsive disorder, OCD in short, for already 20 over years. My first symptoms started when I was working in a hospital lab. I was handling urine samples, and during the first few days when I started working there, I feel uneasy handling the urine sample, and I start washing my hands. Initially, it was just a few seconds, then a few minutes, and then it became a ritual pattern. For me, initially, what the shame was like, shame what if I couldn't function as a normal person at work? Shame if I cannot study like a normal person in the university. I think to me that was my major concern. I had transient thoughts of ending my life because I feel that I cannot bear with the OCD thing anymore. I think things are changing now. People are more open to accepting people with mental illness.
It is better to reach out to employers is to tell them that I have got mental illness. If they want to employ me, means that they are willing to accept me, number one. Number two, if they accept me, they are willing to invest in me, in my recovery, and me being a productive staff to the organization.
When I was attending those family support group, we have other caregivers. Then I find that, oh, after all, I'm not alone. There are still so many people who are suffering only in silence because they didn't have to break up their worries. Then after that, when I come to accept my son got this mental illness, the most important thing for me is to pull him, to guide him, to show him empathy that he can recover from the illness.
Actually, the first emotion we had was regret. Why didn't we sought treatment earlier? But because we had so little understanding of Alzheimer's then.
You need to be well so that the whole family will be well. So because of that, I realized that mental illness is real, but recovery is a choice. Be compassionate to yourself. Don't be too hard on yourself.
I would say to all my fellow OCD sufferer out there, come forward, seek help. When there's a will, there's a way. When there's a hope, there is recovery. So I would say that do not give up, and it's nothing to be ashamed of.
For 15 months, I did not acknowledge us until one fine day, he come and talk to his daddy. He said, thank you, daddy, for not giving me up. And I find that this is the most significant sign in my life as a caregiver, because you can see improvement, you know. They are well known. They know what you are doing. It's just that maybe at that time when they have illness, they just cannot express.
So I know my time is up, but it is important to be able to equip people with mental illness for their independent living. So some of that work, we need more residential step-down care where, you know, it's not a hospital, but it's really trying to get them back in the community. And Singapore, we only have a few centres, really not enough. And the other part is, of course, vocational rehabilitation, which is quite critical, getting them back into a job. You heard Julius. Julius is one of our peer specialists, which we've hired in our hospital, and he feels very strongly. In fact, we have this movement to try and get as many patients back to work. But we need to find employers who are open to get them back to work. And that's where the challenge is. We have one group, quite a large group, the Jardin group. They have actively started to do this. They've set up their own CSR arm called Mindsets, and they are actively trying to help people with mental illness. But we need more companies to come forward and say, look, people with mental illness, they deserve a chance, and we can help. And in partnership, I think SAMH, IMH, we can create an environment, a more caring society here in Singapore. We need to create this community engagement. So we've been inviting. We're probably the only hospital in Singapore that doesn't run away from all the politicians, and we invite them to come and visit us. We want them to see the kind of conditions that our patients sometimes have to live under, and we want them to change the mindset of the community. Because, you know, in the community, sometimes people with mental illness, they always call IMH or call IMH police, as if we have such police. We have caregiver support group in SAMH. We have a family link program, you know, which is basically trying to help families manage and care for people with chronic mental illness. Okay, I don't have much time. I'm just saying that we're starting to do a lot of this, but we need people to know about it. That's why I never turn down an opportunity to speak to any audience, okay, big or small, because I think this is a calling for me. And I hope that you all see this as an area that even when you have a physical illness, think about the mentally ill. When they have a mental illness, I tell you a true story. And this is a specialist, you know, in medicine who said, oh, this person got mental illness. I think must treat conservatively. Right? Because, you know, their life quality of life is very bad. Maybe let them go on. I am shocked, you know, to hear that. And I, you know, it makes me want to say, look, we need to change the mindset of our people. These are people like any one of us. You saw all those videos. Do you think you can tell a person have a mental illness? How would you know? Okay, I hope we can celebrate life, celebrate health, and have good mental health. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Prof.